Om Ajnana Timirandasya Kenandana Sadakya Shakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha Sri Caitanya Manovistam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamaya Dadati Swaparantikam Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Sri Vasadi Gaura Bhaktavinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Hare Krishna. One second. So. Recently, as I have, I was in London, and there I started with Sutapa, working on the Caitanya Charitamrita project as like a long-term study project I've worked on for so many years. And I mentioned that the last few weeks also. But since then, we did a lot of work. I met with Sutapa and team, because he has a team, and working in the school of bhakti. So with that team, we hope to be able to, to work towards a book, and that would be a serious book, at least 3 volumes. There's a lot of work there. But it's nice to work on it with the team. It gave me also some fresh inspiration to work on it, to keep on working on it. Because I started this long ago, but it's been on the shelf for a while. And so I needed some fresh input. So that was good. Meanwhile, I traveled to America and made a short stop in New York. Met with so many people. It was like, did a Harinam on Union Square, which was nice. And then, now I traveled on to Utah. I'm sitting in the Marriott Hotel, where they've put us up, and we are. Yesterday I went to this the temple that Charu and Vaibhavi made, a beautiful temple inspired on the architecture of Kushamsaravar, of the central building. And very nice to see how they have developed this project on a block of land, 20 acres, and in a very interesting way. Besides the temple being like a very nice monumental type of building, based on Rajasthani architecture, and the area is a valley which is surrounded by the Rocky Mountains, snowy mountains, and then in that valley there is a main road going towards the west coast. And they're right off that highway. And there's that beautiful, beautiful temple that, and there's a lot more than that. They have a llama farm. And the llamas are obviously interesting animals. People come to see llamas. They have many peacocks, they have parrots. So in this way, people come and to see what's going on there. It's kind of, there's a nice restaurant, gift shop, and all those things. Quite nicely developed and very dynamic people. I mean, he started that holy festival in the West, you know, like the color festival, which spread from there all over the world, all over America. I myself was in some of those festivals. And they get like huge numbers of people, enormous. So it's absolutely a place to visit, I must say. So I never visited it, and it was on my list of places to visit. So I'm happy that I visited, got the tour yesterday, fed the llamas, and then prayed to the deities, who Charu says are very, very merciful, and they overlook offenses. So I thought, let me take advantage. I like those kind of opportunities. So I prayed there. That was nice. And had lunch with Indrajumna Maharaj, which was also very nice. I mean, such a deep, warm-hearted personality. So fixed in his mind about what he wants to achieve, and then just pushing through and doing things, mobilizing things, and finally, yes, the day before, I had lunch with Sachinandan Swami. So like that, I'm getting some nice opportunities to associate with the Vaishnavas, which is important. It's nourishing, and we need that kind of association. It's very encouraging to see the determination of such Vaishnavas to look at their vision for Krishna consciousness. So in this way, that's why I wound up in Utah, right? Somewhere in, I guess it's even further than the Midwest, near the Rocky Mountains. I'm looking at Murari Gupta, who sits on the other side of the Rocky Mountains. We're just a few mountains apart at the moment, not too far away. yeah, good to see you there. And we're getting ready for a kirtan festival with many wonderful kirtan leaders. So I'm sure that will be also inspiring. Then I'll go back to New York, meet up with the devotees there, have a few meetings also, and about how to push forward New York, and then we'll have Rath Yatra on Fifth Avenue. And afterwards, Washington Square Park, also very nice. And then I'll return to Europe, first to London, and then from there on, here and there, we will see. So that's in a nutshell. an update of where I am. So with all that travel, I had to put a little less energy into my Caitanya Charitamrita work. But in order to stay kind of, they say I should go and visit the 24-hour kirtan in New Vrindavan, which happens after the New York Rati Yatra. Thank you for the invitation. That is very kind of you to think of me. I'm learning from Sachinandan Swami. He is very good at this. Oh, thank you so much. You are an ocean of mercy. Yes. No, but meanwhile, to stay focused on the Caitanya Charitamrita, I've been reading while traveling Kavikarnapur's Caitanya Candrodaya Nataka. I like it very much. Nataka means a play. It's quite a large play. It has some 70 actors, and it's considered to be an authorized biography of Caitanya Mahaprabhu. So it's giving some insights about Caitanya Mahaprabhu's transcendental life and activities. But that's not all. It's also full of very conclusive statements. So the play, it begins basically with Rati Yatra in Jagannath Puri, and then one person, everyone is elated, everyone is happy, it's Rati Yatra, it is exciting, but one person is not at all in a good mood. One person, although there's such a wonderful festival, is depressed. It is Maharaj Prataparuda, the king of Puri, powerful Maharaj Prataparuda who ruled Orissa for so many years, who protected Orissa from the invasion of the Muslims. Maharaj Prataparuda, this powerful Gajapati king, is now, during Rati Yatra, depressed. But how is it possible? This is the king who sweeps the road. It was Maharaj Prataparuda who introduced this principle that the king of Puri goes before Lord Jagannath and sweeps the road. And we even, during our Rati Yatras, also have a representative of Maharaj Prataparuda who sweeps the road before the Rat cart actually begins. So in this way, Maharaj Prataparuda, who showed that he was a servant, although he was the king and the ruler, he showed that he was a servant of Lord Jagannath, the Supreme Lord. That Maharaj Prataparuda was depressed during Rati Yatra. How is it possible? How is it possible? But what comes out then, he is depressed because that particular Rati Yatra that is being described in that play of the Caitanya Candrodaya Nataka is the first Rati Yatra after the departure of Sri Caitanya Mahaprabhu. And Maharaj Prataparuda cannot bear the absence of Sri Caitanya Mahaprabhu at Rati Yatra. And of course, Ratha Yatra has been performed since Satya Yuga. The Skanda Purana is giving extensive information about the worship of Lord Jagannath and the performance of Ratha Yatra. And we understand that since Satya Yuga, this Ratha Yatra has been performed and executed. And now it is being performed in the Kali Yuga. So much time has passed. So many Ratha Yatras have been performed. And the kings of Puri have been part of this Ratha Yatra. And Maharaj Prajaparuda, he basically grew up with it. He performed Ratha Yatra throughout his life. But after he had tasted the presence of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu at Ratha Yatra, everything had changed. Ratha Yatra had taken on other dimensions now in the presence of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Right now, there was kirtan. People were excited. Certainly, they were playing gongs and musical instruments. But that kind of kirtan, that kind of prem sankirtan, that kind of chanting in ecstatic love by all the devotees of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Then Sri Chaitanya himself dancing at Ratha Yatra, that had never, ever been seen before. Miracles were there. The chariot stopped and somehow or other wouldn't move. The king got strong, restless to try and pull, but they couldn't move the chariot. The king had elephants brought and chained them to the chariot to pull the chariot. The elephants were pulling with their maximum strength and to no avail. The chariot didn't move. But then Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, release the elephant. And Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he, with his head, he went behind the chariot and pushed with his head mildly. He told all his followers to take the ropes in their hands, but they didn't pull. The chariot was just moving. And they didn't even pull the chariot. Maharaj Prataparuda had all these details of seeing Chaitanya Mahaprabhu were just vividly, vividly present in his memory. And yet, now there was Ratha Yatra. And now, all that was not there. No, Maharaj Prataparuda could not bear it. So Maharaj Prataparuda, to overcome separation, had actually commissioned a play. This is what is written. Play begins to unfold. In that play, then, in the first chapter, there is a meeting of Kali and Adharma, or irreligion. And they have a discussion. And in that discussion, what comes up is that now Kali is seeing the influence of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He knows that his business is finished. Adharma, irreligion, says, my dear Kali, you are the ruler. You are the king of this entire era. No one can escape. So why have you suddenly become like in such a mood of defeatism? Defeated by some Brahmana boy? Kali says, Adharma, you have no idea. He's not just a Brahmana boy. He is the Supreme Personality of Godhead himself. It's like, you know, surely, right? Adharma is trying. Surely he can be corrupted. His followers can be corrupted. And he goes through the six enemies, greed, anger, pride he touches upon, envy, illusion, madness, and finally lust. He says, yes. So he goes through many details in this way, many details. But Kali is pointing out that no, he cannot be defeated by any of these temptations. He cannot be defeated by any means. And his followers will just be immune to these weaknesses. Yeah. So, also there is then a description, I would say, yes, adjustment. So, also there is a description of the Mahaprakash Lila, which is the spontaneous Abhishek that took place in the house of Srivas when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu first revealed his identity as the Supreme Lord. He sat on the altar in Srivas's house for 21 hours. And then a spontaneous Abhishek took place. So this whole thing is described, and it just is very interesting. But yeah, there are so many details, and I can't get into everything. Then there is a portion where there is renunciation personified. Actually, it begins with friendship. Friendship. Friendship is wandering around the world. Friendship is feeling very, very depleted and emaciated and weakened. Practically speaking, friendship is barely alive. Then friendship is wandering about and is looking, is there still? The whole world is just corrupted. Is there still somewhere some purity to be found? And he looks and he sees some yogi. And he seems to be serious. And he thinks, yes, yes, maybe here is someone. But this yogi turns out to be very proud. And actually, Frank says, no, he's not a devotee. He's a demon. In this way, friendship cannot find anyone who is sincere. And it says, like, people are only practicing something spiritual in name, for name, fame, and for recognition. Said, brahmacharis are those who somehow or other couldn't manage to get married. In this way, everyone is just become, there's no more substance in life. So, and then after this difficult search of friendship personified, somehow or other, friendship comes into contact with love of God personified. And love of God is in a state of, is flourishing. Love of God is in complete ecstasy and friendship. Cannot imagine friendship. So how is this possible? He said, everyone is emaciated. He said, renunciation, knowledge, they are totally depleted, nothing left of them. And how is it that you, O love of God, my old friend, are flourishing? How can it be? Then love of God begins to speak about the miracle of Lord Chaitanya's movement, and all that is coming out in the discussion. At one point, it begins to describe how Lord Chaitanya is performing a play in the house of Chandrasekhar. And when that play is being performed, it is Lord Chaitanya is playing the goddess of fortune, Srimati Radharani herself. Advaita Acharya will play the Supreme Lord. And Haridas, Haridas will be the narrator who will introduce the entire play. Srivas will be Narada Muni. So like this, everyone is, those who are allowed to be there are eagerly waiting for the play to begin. And then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu appears in that mood of Srimati Radharani. And there is Radharani in a mood of great separation, wandering in search of Krishna. At one point, Krishna comes on the stage, not unseen by Radharani. And Krishna is just Krishna himself. Friendship says, how is it possible that the plenary portion of the Lord, Advaita Acharya, becomes the Lord? He said, because Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself has entered within him and empowered him. Therefore, he can play the part of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Otherwise, it would not be possible. In this way, Krishna is manifest, Radharani is manifest. When Srivas comes on stage, there's Narada Muni. How come Narada has appeared? Because Narada has fully entered within Srivas. When Srivas was a young man, then Srivas was a bit of the party type. Oh, yes, Srivas, he was, you know, enjoying sense gratification. Srivas was living a life not exactly following the rules of Dharma. Oh, no, Srivas would drink things you don't drink, would be with ladies you're not supposed to be with. What shall we say? Well, but Srivas. One day an astrologer predicted, a renowned astrologer, that he would die exactly 1 year from that day. So Srivas was shocked because, such a prediction. Not what you want to hear. You know, 1 year from that day. Yes. So Srivas totally changed and he became serious during that year. And he began to cultivate his Krishna consciousness. He was Antakala Chamam Vivasmaran Mukta Kalevram, preparing to remember the Lord at the end of his life. So as Srivas considered he had 1 year to live, he just focused, and he would hear regularly the Bhagavatam lectures by Devananda Pandit. One day, on that particular day, the day that it was predicted would be the end of his life, Devananda Pandit, like usual, speaking on Bhagavatam. Srivas was listening. And as Srivas was listening, the lectures were on the first floor in the house, not on the ground floor, but one floor up. Right? So not American first floor. In America, first floor is ground floor, but British first floor, one floor up. Right? So one floor up, there he was. And suddenly he couldn't breathe. He was suffocating. So he went outside to get some air. There was a big balcony. He went on the balcony. But as he was on the balcony, he was trying to breathe and he became dizzy. And as he became dizzy, he fell. He fell over the railing. And he was just heading straight for the ground. When out of nowhere, this unknown personality suddenly grabbed him mid-air, captured him, and laid him down on the ground. Srivas was one moment he was falling and ready to go, and next moment he was caught mid-air, still alive. And next moment, some transcendental energy entered within him. As he was still dizzy, as he was still recovering, he felt the power of Narada enter within him. Anyhow, people from everywhere were there. They just, this man, he almost died. And somehow or other, he was saved. He was saved and he wasn't well. They carried him to his house. He was lying on his bed and just slept. He slept. And the next morning, he woke up and he was looking to start his day with some reading of scripture. And he picked up a manuscript of the Brihannaradiya Purana. And in there was the verse, Harinama, Harinama, Harinama eva kevalam, kalo nasteva, 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 katiranyata. So as he read that verse, Harinama, Harinama, Harinama eva kevalam, only by chanting the holy name, there's no other way, no other way, no other way to attain perfection in this age of Kali. It was then and there that Srivas embraced this instruction and that he started Harinam Sankirtan in his house. Srivas was a contemporary of the parents of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So he was some 35 years older than Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So for a long time, even before the birth of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the kirtan had been going on in the house of Srivas. And, or maybe not before the birth, but at least during the youth of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Exact dates also not known. And it must be before the birth. He's 35 years in this young men, so yes, before the birth. And then every night that kirtan had started. So now so many years later, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had revealed his transcendental identity. He was a young Brahmana, Vishwambar. Ananta says had personally become the Brahmin thread on his broad chest. Now there was a play. Now that Vishwambar had revealed to the devotees his transcendental energy, his transcendental identity,
and he had his followers, and there was an assembly of devotees. Now that assembly of devotees of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu were together with Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, relishing this transcendental nectar of worshipping Krishna. Bhaja Krishna, Bolo Krishna, Kaur Krishna Sika. Worship Krishna, chant the name of Krishna, and discuss about Krishna and the nature of Krishna and the tattva of Krishna, the Krishna tattva. So in this way, it was going on. Then, during that play, Srivast now revealed his full identity as Narada Muni. So you can understand that the play that is being described in the Caitanya Candrodaya Nataka is something not of this world, that it is a completely transcendental experience. Here is Caitanya Mahaprabhu. He is Radharani. He is the goddess of fortune. Here is Advaita Acharya, now empowered by Caitanya Mahaprabhu, playing Krishna. Here is Srivas. He is Narada Muni. And so just getting the darshan of the actors on stage was something overwhelming. Now that we've come this far, I'm going to carry on and read something. Let's go back. So it is said that let's go back a little bit. Okay, where do I begin reading? Maybe. He is splendid as a new cloud and more charming than millions of Kamadevas. His face is glorious as the autumn full moon. His large red eyes are new lotus petals, and his bimba fruit lips are splendid with the flowers of his teeth. He's coming here. Let us hide in this grove and watch, Snataka. So be it. They do that. Sri Krishna, friend Subal, friend Sridham, friend Sudama, why do I not see my dear friend, the Brahmana, Kusumasava? Kusumasava is Madhumanga. Please go and look for him. Friends, as you order, we will search for him. They search for him. Tossing the curtain aside, the buffoon hastily answered. Buffoon, that's Madhumangala, of course. Oh, friend, save me, save me. Sri Krishna, why are you afraid? Buffoon, friend, I just now saw an old yogini leading to the forest five pretty young girls to worship Lord Shiva. Only by your mercy did I escape. They would have captured me and offered me to the deity. That is why I am afraid. Sri Krishna, laughing. Friend, Subal, what is this? Subal, I've been standing here, but I understand. Although forbidden by her elders, with her grandmother, Radha happily came on her own to the forest to worship Lord Shiva. Seeing the grandmother and mistakenly thinking her a yogini, this Brahmana boy became afraid. Actually, the grandmother is famous as one of the Lord's internal potencies. Buffoon, ha ha, if that is so, then all these girls are about to fall into my dear friend's hand. My dear friend's glorious virtues are a hunter's trap to capture the beautiful does that are Gokula's girls. Narada, Snataka, we should not stay here. By our mystic power, let us go into the sky and watch from there. A voice from behind the scenes. Alas, noble lady, by what path can we approach Lord Shiva? Collecting tolls in different places and his hands itching for mischief, a wicked jungle elephant entices many pious young girls in this place. Subal, friend, my words have borne their fruit. Kusumasava, will my words not also bear fruit? You carry a great burden of false pride. To Krishna, friend, now you should prepare for this event. Sri Krishna, what is the event? Kusumasava, you did not hear the words? Collecting tolls in different places and his hands itching for mischief. A wicked jungle elephant entices many pious young girls in this place. The word jungle elephant is appropriate, but the word wicked brings me pain. Sri Krishna, laughing and hiding his real feelings, why does it pain you that a jungle elephant is called wicked? Kusumasava, aside from you, is there another elephant in this forest? Again, a voice from behind the scenes, diving again onto the forest path. This elephant enjoys the toll, collecting pastime with his elephant friends. Alas, how will we go to our destination? Kusumasava, friend, let us hide for a moment in this grove. Thinking all is safe, these girls will come here. Everyone, it is so. With Krishna, they enter the grove. So now we are here in the middle of a biography that deals with Lord Chaitanya. And Lord Chaitanya is with his associates. Lord Chaitanya is having intimate meetings. It is basically the devotees. The devotees are now gathering together. There's no outsiders. Oh no, outsiders not present. This is where the devotees are meeting, and it is what the devotees are doing. Yes, when devotees gather, there is kirtan. When devotees gather, there is katha. When devotees gather, there is prasadam. These are the activities of the Vaishnava. So now here in this play, we are in the middle of the activities of the Vaishnavas. And in these activities have taken us into a play. Not only are the Vaishnavas performing kirtan, not only are the Vaishnavas discussing Krishna Katha, but plays are also very much part of the Vaishnava tradition. When Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his associates were meeting, they were performing plays. And as we see, they took up the roles of Krishna and his associates. And so, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his associates were now deeply in Vrindavan. A wicked jungle elephant. Yes. Yes, Krishna and his cowherd boyfriends waiting in hiding in a grove. The scene has been set. The scene has been set for the pastimes of Radha and Krishna. Let us see. Beautiful as the goddess of fortune, and beautiful as a newly sprouted white flower bud, and accompanied by her elderly grandmother and friends, holding articles of worship in their hands, Sri Radha enters. Sri Radha, friends, Have we brought everything we need to worship Lord Shiva? Her friends, yes, we didn't bring the flowers. They would wilt on the way. We will pick them here. Sri Radha, you make me happy. You make me happy. Come, we will pick them. They pick flowers. Love of God, looking. Ah, wonderful. Caitanya is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Nothing is impossible for him. For Lord Vishvambar, who as his partial expansion Mohini Devi bewildered the demigods' enemies and filled Lord Shiva, the spiritually blissful king of the demigods, with lust, who descended as Lord Krishna and was now assumed Sri Radha's form. Nothing is surprising. Or perhaps it is that by his own pastime potency, the Lord has divided into two equal parts, a man and a woman, as a pea is divided into two. Looking in another place, Radhika's friend Lalita is not the great Brahmana, Gadadhar. By his own potency, Lord Hari has become three himself, Radha and Radha's friend. Lord Hari has become three himself, Radha and Radha's friend. Looking in again another place, Goddess Yogamaya, who subdues sins, who is peaceful, and who is untouched by passion, whose eyes are like lotus flower and whose hair is white as the darkness of ignorance, turned to pure goodness, has appeared as Radha's grandmother. This is not Nityananda. Nityananda, who is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, made Yogamaya appear here. This is not surprising, because then it stops. So we see what the because is. Because, as a great devotee in ancient times said, Yamunacharya, Stota Ratna, text 37, O Lord, for your sake, Ananta assumes many shapes to become your residence. Bed, throne, sandals, garments, pillow, umbrella, parasol, many other objects. In this way, he's known to the people as your Sesha paraphernalia. So, interesting. Now that there is a play, normally Nityananda appears as the bed, he appears as the play, the plate, he appears as whatever paraphernalia the Lord needs. And now that there is a play, and now that there is a need for Yogamaya to appear, all right, Nityananda becomes Yogamaya. Because Nityananda is the, fully dedicated servant of the Lord. He becomes everything that the Lord needs. Nityananda has become Yogamaya. Yes, it's logical. Kavi Karnapur explains, because after all, he becomes the plate. He becomes everything. Yes. So how nice, isn't it? I find it. I like this. I hope you too. I find this play something extremely interesting. Not this particular play that is now being performed by Lord Caitanya, but the bigger play that we're discussing, Caitanya Candrodaya Nataka. If I go back a little bit to the meeting between friendship and love of God, at one point, love of God is pointing out that we can, now, by the mercy of Caitanya Mahaprabhu, directly taste the greater emotions and ecstasies of Krishna consciousness. But says friendship says, yes, but you know, those who try to go directly without following the paths of the regulations of the scriptures, right, their endeavors will not bear fruit. One has to go the path of the and follow the regulations of the scriptures. Love of God said, not always, not always. He said, when there's a flood, then you can take a boat and you can go directly to your goal. You don't need to follow the winding course of the path. So in this way, Kavi Karnapur is pointing out, now there is a shortcut by the mercy of Sri Caitanya. What shall I say? We are here in the middle of this Caitanya Candrodaya Nataka. And obviously, I cannot cover it today. That will not be possible. Okay, 1 second. Okay, 1 second. Once again, in the Zoom. This Caitanya Candrodaya Nataka is one of the, in the Caitanya Charitamrita, it is referred to as an authorized biography about Sri Caitanya Mahaprabhu. It gives us a lot of insights, a lot of understanding. We can see how Lord Caitanya is with his devotees absorbed in hearing and chanting about Krishna. Sometimes performing plays to remember Krishna. We read in Caitanya Charitamrita that on a Nrisinga Chaturdasi, Lord Caitanya got so much into the mood of Lord Nrisinga that he looked like Lord Nrisinga, and it became so intense that people were just running in fear, and some people just climbed into poles and anything to run. Then Lord Caitanya, he came to his external senses and gave up that mood of Lord Nrisingadev, because he said, it is not good. It is an offense to cause fear to people. It's an offense. Yes. So no, that I should not do. Yes. So in this way, we see how Lord Caitanya and his associates are deeply, deeply absorbed in Krishna. They're not only just preaching. Lord Caitanya is Prithivityachi Yatanagara Digram Sarvata Prachara Hoivamuranam. He's preaching in every town and village. Yes, he is. But when with the devotees, then they are drinking this Krishna Katha. So my dear devotees, this is the one thing we have to learn. This is the one thing we have to practice. This is the one thing we have to take up, that when we assemble together and that we spend time to deeply absorb ourselves in this hearing and chanting. And then we will get the taste, we will get the inspiration. And with taste, we can preach. When preaching with taste, our preaching is potent and powerful. When preaching, our taste becomes something very different. So this is it. We are going to the well. Today, we went to the well of the Caitanya Candrodaya Nataka. And I was pulling up some buckets for you of that ocean of nectar that is the Caitanya Candrodaya Nataka. And just so that we taste and that we say yes. But my point was not to just discuss the Caitanya Candrodaya Nataka. My point was to say, yes, you also take a bucket. You all take buckets and you all go to different wells. Right? Yes, pull up these buckets. I used to live in Vrindavan for many years, and yes, and we had to pull up the buckets of water. Of course, you know, for 1 rupee, there was also one lady who would pull up some buckets, and my former wife would sometimes would pay the 1 rupee, but you know, then we had a few full buckets, but how many full buckets can you have, right? So yes, you come home, there's a full bucket, but then the full bucket is empty before you know it, and then you have to pull up your own bucket again. So bucket pulling was my daily activity. It was bucket yoga. It was very nice. It kept me fit. Pulling up 15 kilos, 15 liters of water was, was a good exercise. Yes. Yes. Of course, some pull only half a bucket, but not me, full bucket. Yes. So, 15 kilos. So that was my my exercise. It was very good. And let us throw buckets into different wells, into the well of the Caitanya Charitamrita. Then let us look into the well. Let us look into the well of the other biographies. And if we do so, the interesting thing is, when we go to Lord Caitanya, then Lord Caitanya takes us to Krishna. This is the amazing thing. And as Lord Caitanya takes us to Krishna, then Krishna takes us to Lord Caitanya. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, in Adi Lila, chapter 8, in one of the purports, in that chapter is the chapter dedicated to the author of the Caitanya Charitamrita and the author receiving his orders to write. And Sri Caitanya Mahaprabhu is saying, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur was saying that in the course of worshipping Sri Caitanya Mahaprabhu, we should not worship Sri Caitanya Mahaprabhu to the exclusion of Radha and Krishna. And we should not worship Radha and Krishna to the exclusion of Sri Caitanya Mahaprabhu. We should worship both. Then I'd like to offer, I thought about this, and I'd like to offer a thought from my side. And the thought that I have in this regard is this. It is a thought based on my own experience. When I was there in Vrindavan, this magical place, you can sense the presence of Krishna everywhere. And where you don't sense, you are in the association of all the devotees that are worshiping Krishna. The devotees have built temples. The devotees have installed deities. The devotees have started worship, and this worship continues. And everywhere there are devotees. Everyone says Radhe Radhe, even rickshawalas who were not cultured, call out, Radhe, meaning get out of the way. Yes, all right, yes. So in this way, that Vrindavan, naturally, everyone can sense the presence of Krishna. So I felt it. I came there. I felt it. And in the beginning, I just stood there in the Krishna Balaram Mandir, appreciating the beauty of the deities and just being there, standing in front of Krishna Balaram Radha Shama Sundar and seeing their incredible beauty and praying to them. But over time, I realized that Radha and Krishna and their associates, Alita Vishaka, the Astasakhi, and all the Manjaris, that they are all absorbed in pure love of God, and that they are overwhelmed in the ecstatic waves of pure love of God. And I realized I'm the outsider. I don't have such love. I don't even know what such love is. I have heard about it. I have read about it. But I have not tasted it. I don't know that depth. So I encountered my limitations. And so my thought is, and my experience was, that then, as I encountered my limitations, then I needed mercy. So I turned to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And I went to the deities of Gornitai and I prayed for mercy. In this way, there's the dynamics between Radha Krishna's pastimes and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. We turn to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. We enter the pastimes of Krishna by the mercy of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. We hear about the pastimes of Krishna. We meditate about the pastimes of Krishna. We try to understand the pastimes of Radha and Krishna. And when we meet the limits of our love, then we turn to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and pray. Not only do we pray, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is himself an ocean of transcendental love. This ocean of transcendental love is spilling over in all directions. So this love is spilling over from Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and flooding the directions. And therefore, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, out of his pure love, is flooding the entire world with his great mercy. And so Krishna consciousness is spreading to every town and village. It's everywhere. Everywhere is the chanting of the holy name. And so this chanting of the holy name is just giving everyone some taste. And we chant first the name, Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Sri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. And by the mercy of Lord Chaitanya and Lord Nityananda, who are like the sun and the moon appearing simultaneously, ecstasy awakens quickly. Then when we chant, suddenly this chanting becomes very ecstatic. And we are ecstatic. We get some taste beyond our level, beyond our level. Suddenly we are at a level and we have some taste which we never imagined, never. We thought, this is beyond us. We saw ourselves just as, ordinary people of this world, and what taste do we have for such pastimes? But suddenly some taste begins to come, and we bring some taste. Maybe not the depth of love of God that Lord Chaitanya, that Radha and Krishna, their associates have, but we bring some taste. And now we look at these pastimes renewed, and they look different with taste. They look different. There's different meaning to them. Then after a while, again, we encounter the limits of our love. And then again, after some time, we are. Then after some time, we are again turning to Lord Chaitanya. And we see how he's flooding the world with love of God. And now we become his assistant. And we become carriers of that love of God. And we are doing it in so many ways. Some distribute books. Some are just going out collecting donations. Some have collected in all kinds of situations. horse races. I'm trying to wake up Padmanabha because it looks like he's falling asleep. It's very early in the morning. How do I make a sound?
Ah! Ooh!
No, yes. Some are going out to the horse races and collect. And some people think that this collecting is just about money, but no, it's not. It's about engaging people, engaging the fruits of their labor, and taking the fruits of their labor and engaging them in the service of the Lord. And in this way, these are the merciful Sankirtan devotees that taste the nectar, of giving out mercy. And they touch the lives of many people. And in this way, the Sankirtan movement spreads everywhere. Yeah, it's like, I tried, and it spreads everywhere. So, dear devotees, I'm very happy to be with you all. So I brought some of my meditation on Lord Chaitanya and his mercy. I brought it with me to America, and I'm with great happiness enjoying this discussion based on Caitanya Candrodaya Nataka, and then put into a framework of Caitanya Charitamrita with some thoughts that I have offered to you. These thoughts have come due to my experience in life, because of my some or other joining Vrindavan, staying in Vrindavan, and like that. Yeah, I am happy to share that with you today. Take a few questions before we move on with the day. Meanwhile, I just look at my phone for a minute because I have to see when they're coming to pick us up and take us to the site. Not yet. Okay. Well, let's stay where we are then. Okay, so let us see. Raja Shekhar.
Hi, Krishna Gurumaraj. Thank you for the lovely talk on Lord Chaitanya. I just have a question from the Chaitanya Bhagavat. And I'm just going to read the paragraph because it was the first time I read something like this. So I wasn't sure if I was understanding it correctly. So this is from Antyakanda chapter 7, where Lord Chaitanya is actually glorifying Lord Nityananda. And he says, in truth, the ninefold path of pure bhakti eternally embellishes you. Yet the serpent, which is the eternal embellishment of Lord Shiva, is not properly understood by all. According to their transcendental relationship, Anantashesh is most dear to Lord Shiva. So Sri Ananta takes the form of a serpent and remains around the neck of Lord Shiva. Without this knowledge, people criticize the character of Shiva and as a result must suffer dire consequences. So it was the first time I read that, and I never ever thought that the snake around Lord Shiva is actually Anantashesh. So can you just comment on that?
Of course, we're talking in particularly about Sada Shiva. When the tattva, the Shambhu tattva, or the truth about Lord Shiva, is that there are two manifestations of Lord Shiva. One manifestation of Lord Shiva is a direct expansion of Mahavishnu. And that's why in the Caitanya Charitamrita, Advaita Acharya is described as Mahavishnu, and in the Caitanya Bhagavat as Shiva. So we're talking about Lord Shiva being Sada Shiva, the expansion of Mahavishnu. And that Mahavishnu glances upon the material world. Lord Sada Shiva becomes the person who touches who touches the material energy, he becomes the glands of Mahavishnu. So he touches the pradhana, and then all the living entities are entering through that glands into the material energy, and then they are basically getting purified in the material energy by three modes of material nature, and after many, many lifetimes, going back to Godhead, right? So in this way, Lord Shiva is instrumental in bringing the in bringing all the living beings back to the spiritual world. So Ananta Sesh, who is the servant of the Lord, is fulfilling the desire of the Lord. Ananta Sesh is always glorifying the Supreme Lord with his millions of mouths, and he never finishes. And Ananta Sesh is, in other words, is the he's in a sense an original Sankirtan devotee. He is glorifying the Lord. So Ananta says, he joins Lord Shiva. Lord Shiva then, who comes as Advaita Acharya. Advaita Acharya is particularly as Sada Shiva. And now he has placed the living beings in the material world. Now it is by his desire that all these living beings are not only going out of the material world, but they're getting love of God. So it is Advaita Acharya is fulfilling this mission. He is Sada Shiva. So Ananta says is right by his side. Okay? He's right by his side, and therefore he's very close to him. He's also in that same mission. And Ananta says is manifesting as Nityananda, and Lord Shiva is manifesting as Advaita. And so these two are very intimate. They're very close. That's why in the whole Chaitanya Bhagavata, Chaitanya Charitamrita, they're close friends. Yeah? And they have all these pastimes together. They have that intimate connection. That, yes. So we can see how they are eternally, intimately connected in glorifying Krishna. And increasing the glories of Krishna everywhere and anywhere. So it's not surprising that Ananta says is there around the neck of Lord Sadashiva.
Thank you very much for that answer. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ravinda Swarup. Hare Krishna. Yeah, it will take a moment. You are still muted, Ravindra Shroop. Can you unmute? Or I don't know if you can, but...
Yeah.
Okay.
Can you hear me now? Dandavat Pranam.
Hi.
Again. Nice to see you again, Maharaj.
Thank
very
you.
Very glad to see you every week here.
Yes.
And Mataji, a very good association. Can you explain the reason why non-Hindus and some lower class Hindus even not allowed in the Jagannath Puri temple?
Well, in India, Vedic culture took its own historical development naturally. I mean, it's not that Vedic culture is at all times in history the same. You know, as Kali Yuga sets in, Vedic culture is going down in its quality. As Kali Yuga is setting in, gradually Vedic culture becomes more and more external. And the deeper devotional internal meaning of the Vedas is getting lost. Yeah. So what happened was that in an earlier stage of Vedic culture, the emphasis was on self-realization and on going back to Godhead. But when we come to the age of Kali, we are looking more and more at the parts of the Vedas where people are interested in Karmakanda, in getting blessings for their material activities. So basically, the Karmakanda is explained in the Dharma Shastra, or the Dharma Smriti, the Manusmriti, and others. So the Manusmriti gives us extensive descriptions of the various rituals that are to be performed to get auspiciousness in the different phases of life, in what's called the rites of passage. How to conceive a child, how to get blessings when the child is in the womb. Marriage, of course. Then the child is namkarana, the beginning of the name, then the education, many, many sanskaras. So the Dharma Shastra is dealing with the sanskaras and that bless the everyday things of life. And that's basically Karmakanda and creates an auspicious environment, you know, and that's a foundation for practicing devotional service. But Karmakanda without devotional service has no value. So what happened was more and more focus on the externals of the Karmakanda, less and less focus on the devotional side of life. So for approximately the last more than 1,000 years, this became predominant. And smarter Brahmanism became, the Brahmanas that were particularly expert at the Smriti, at the Manusmriti, they became predominant. And they, on the strength of, began to claim Brahminical status by birth. And everything became, so when that started to happen, yes, then that started to predominate. The whole culture of India for at least 1,000 years. It became a whole oppressive system, right? And we can, you know, we can see that devotion was no longer the criterion. It was the status of birth became the criterion, the Brahminical, the Brahmins then were predominating society as a whole and just ordering everyone and living of charity and then the whole Vedic system became an oppressive system. And the sudras and lower class, they were barred from entrance in the temples and so on. And it became, even in some places, South India, you hear that it's mentioned that in the Manusmriti, it mentions that when a Brahmana wants to study Shastra, he has to fast and perform austerity. Then after having done so, then he can study the scripture. But if he sees a sudra, he becomes contaminated, then he has to fast again. So therefore, it became a custom. Brahmanas lived in one village, sudras lived in other villages. Sudras would only come into Brahmin areas to do some necessary cleaning or some repairs or something like that. Or sweepers would come like that. And when they would come, they would have to ring a bell so that even their shadow could not touch the shadow of the Brahmana, so that the Brahmana would not become contaminated. So from here comes this whole culture of...
Okay. Is it also true, Maharaj, that they are scared that foreigners and Muslims will plunder the temple because in the past they have done this a lot of times?
Those may be the secondary reasons, you know. That's called Gramya Kata. Gramya Gita means village talk, you know. The village talk will certainly say, oh, yes, watch out for these people. They are low class, you know. You can steal everything from the temple. No. It's correct that we don't have any. So this is Gramya Gita.
Yeah, because they say there is enormous treasure in the temple. They have hidden for 1,000 layers gold and coins and all kinds of ornaments and jewels.
don't say it too loud.
One disciple of Gaur Gobinda Maharaj had investigated. Okay, Maharaj, thank you very much for your great answer. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Hare Krishna.
Okay, then we can shortly answer 3 more questions and then we'll end. Because you have 7 minutes, so let's keep a little short. Vinuya? You have to unmute. No.
Hare Krishna, Debo Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisances. Jai Shri Prabhupada. I'm very happy that you had so wonderful association. I have a question to the purport of Bhagavad Gita 10:35. This is the verse where Krishna says, under poetry, I'm the Gayatri. And in the purport, Srila Prabhupada mentioned, because the Gayatri mantra is especially meant for God realization, it represents the Supreme Lord. This mantra is meant for spiritual advanced people, and when one attains success in chanting it, he can enter into the transcendental position of the Lord. One must first acquire the qualities of the perfectly situated person, the qualities of goodness according to the laws of material nature, in order to chant the Gayatri mantra. What does it mean, the qualities of goodness according to the laws of material nature? Could you please explain this?
In chapter 18, we find the description of the qualities of the mode of goodness. So each of the 3 modes of material nature have their qualities. Then the qualities of the mode of goodness, sense, equipoise, sense control, tolerance, religiousness, and many more, cleanliness. These are qualities that are part of the mode of goodness. So the Gayatri mantra requires that we are situated in the mode of goodness so that we can approach Krishna with proper respect, with proper attention. Proper respect is not just sort of quickly saying, yes, Krishna, I respect you, but it's also a certain lifestyle, a certain of submission, a lifestyle of tolerance, a lifestyle of cleanliness, a lifestyle. Then we can actually remember Krishna. The Gayatri mantra is a mantra which is chanted in the mind, and therefore it's a meditative mantra, because in the mind we meditate. So the Gayatri mantra is very deep. There are 7 Gayatri mantras. They have deep meanings, and through these mantras we are very deeply meditating on Krishna. So in this way, Lord Brahma was chanting one of the Gayatri mantras and attained the spiritual world through that. So there is a path. There's a path of meditating through the Gayatri mantra. However, in this age of Kali, because we are not so in the mode of goodness, the chanting of Hare Krishna is immediately available to even those who are not in the mode of goodness, and lifts us up to the topmost platform of Visuddha Prem, of pure unalloyed love. So in that way, the same result is attained that Lord Brahma attained from chanting the Gayatri. We attain to the chanting of Hare Krishna. For us, the Gayatri mantra is a further reinforcement. It's situated in the mode of goodness, deepens our meditation, and brings back that wealth to the chanting of Hare Krishna. And in this way, we
we chant them in combination. We chant them. But without the chanting of the Maha Mantra, it would be incomplete for us. Hare Krishna. Yes, the next one. Yes, Krishna Kirtan. You're muted still. Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, now we can hear you.
Weird to see you in the box after so long. This thing of what Kavi Karnapur has done about Maharaj Pratapurudra is interesting, that he's a leader of the community as the king.
Give me 1 second. I just need to tell me that we're leaving in 20 minutes, because otherwise I just get the message now. And then he's not going to do it. Yeah. Not picking up. That's not good. Okay. Yes, go ahead. Maharaj Pratapurudha.
So he is...
He picked up. Leaving. You have to be done, ready in 15 minutes.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Haribo. Told him 15.
Experienced, seasoned professional. So yes, he's a leader of a community, but after Mahaprabhu's departure at that first Rath Yatra, Kavi Karnapur has showed him as having somewhat a weakness as a leader, in the sense that he's displaying his feelings. And I'm just trying to correlate this to maybe the first Rath Yatra without Prabhupada, and how TKG and leaders had to be, and imagine the first King's Day without you, or the first, you know, birthday of a child who's passed away, etc. Like, what is our responsibility? Usually I would think that actually as a leader, you have to just carry on your service and hide your emotions, but maybe you could comment a little bit about this.
Yeah, okay. As a leader, yes, the king was a leader. And as a leader, things have to go on. And things did go on, and the king was also there. But his feelings are very strong, because his feelings were related to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. His feelings were not just, as I said, not just on the level of our feelings. There was a depth of love that Maharaj Pratapurudha had that we don't even know. And we also know from Chaitanya Charitamrita that when love goes very deep, that the feelings sometimes become very overwhelming and almost difficult to contain. So this was not a sign of weakness. This was just a sign that Maharaj Pratapurudha had really come to the level of praying, and therefore was experiencing deep separation. And his feelings were stronger than anything we know in this world. Still, he went on, he carried on. He did not give up his service as the king. Still, he was the leader. Still, he protected the kingdom for many more years, and he kept the Muslim invasion out. You know, which was something like really, like Russia, you know, right now in Ukraine, you see, like, it's just keep on battering, you know, keep on battering. And it was a situation like that, right, where Muslims kept on coming and kept on coming and trying to conquer. So one could win one battle, then another battle, and so many more battles. Eventually, Orissa did fall, right? But not during the reign of Maharaj Pratapurudha. He kept Orissa throughout his entire reign. So Maharaj Pratapurudha very much held the fort, so to speak, very much was there as a leader. But he was also more than a king. He was a pure devotee of the Lord. And as such, he was a Prema Bhakta. we naturally had some separation. Now, in our case, you know, although we don't have such depth of emotions, we also have emotions. And naturally, there will be separation. There will be also, if we have, Vaishnavas leave this world, just like Srila Prabhupada's disciples when Prabhupada left, were overwhelmed by separation, but they had to carry on and they had to take responsibility. Some may have felt deeper separation than others, but the point is this, is that, and maybe when we are still conditioned, maybe some wouldn't mind to sort of now rise to the fore as the new leaders, that there may be mixed devotions, that all these things can happen when there's a lack of love. But anyhow, we turn, like I discussed in the lecture, when there's lack of love, we turn to the mission of Sri Caitanya Mahaprabhu. And just by distributing that mercy, we'll become more and more surcharged with transcendence. Then we can fulfill that leadership in a better way until we grow also deeper in our love. Anyway, that's my reflection. I got to end, dear Krishna Kirtan. I'll surely see you upon my return from NYC. I'll quickly answer Beni Madhavi's questions because I'm a few minutes over time and I have to start going. So Beni Madhavi, yes. Yeah, you're muted. Muted. Yes.
Dear Krishna Guru Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Sri Prabhupada, all glories to you. I have a question. If you can give two answers, two-part answers for it, please. We have in the Paris temple one devotee, old devotee who has been joined age 17 but already old now, and for some reason or for some the temple authorities decide to put him out of the temple, but old devotee, how does it happen for him, and us who see, how is it supposed to happen?
What to do? I showed it, one answer I showed with my hands, right? I showed like here, then I showed the practical situation, and I showed the difficulties on the head. So there's these different dynamics in such a situation. Not everyone is suitable to live in a temple. Some people are better situated at home and practice Krishna consciousness there. Sometimes it's not a bad thing when a person moves out of a temple, because at home we have more room for individual expression, and some people outgrow temple life and need to live in a private environment, you see. So the management has these difficult decisions to make. They are closer to the situation. They may be more aware of some of the issues that play. It may not all come out to the public. Of course, now that devotee is on the outside, we should make sure that the devotee remains connected to Krishna consciousness, to the temple. We should visit the devotee, or we should invite him or her to join temple functions and so on, festivals, keep a connection. We have a responsibility to look after each other and protect each other's Krishna consciousness, because we are a community of devotees. But maybe living together under one roof is not always the best arrangement. And management has to deal with such questions and issues. That's the best I can do for you, Beni Madhavi, because I have to go, because the devotees will be waiting for me downstairs, and I don't want to keep them. And I have to quickly organize myself before I go.
and put the necessary things in my bag so that I don't forget my water, because I am here in a desert. It is very dry. It is known as a desert. So you must excuse me now, but I thank you very much.
Thank you, Guru Maharaj. Thank you a lot. You're very pleasant.
Yes, and thank you very much for your question. And forgive my jokes about the French accent. I can't resist. It's too good to resist. Of course, I can also do the German accent and the other ones. They are also very good. Yes. And then I, of course, like to do Sachinandan Swami. But now I have to take your leave. And I thank you and hope to see you again next week. And maybe you'll see us online for the Sadhu Sangha Kirtans. Hare Krishna. All glories to Srila Prabhupada.